Welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. Welcome to the special 100th episode, which is going to be a 1 hour long or so episode. Now going to little Nihliesh. Behold. Orving is supposedly here, Tiber's lover, as well as these two thugs that we're supposed to find. As you enter the slum, you nearly crash into a small confrontation. We got a codex. Five mutants surround the three guards dressed in the distinctive garb of the Memovira's enforcers. This must be one of Bruska's lost patrols. Before you hear them say a word, you already know the mood here is ugly, and it's likely to turn to violence soon. A mutant, who looks like his face is full of spores or insect eggs, leans toward a disgusted, terrified human and says, "You're leaving a trail of fear piss. Who'd pay you for protection?" He thinks, "We're done with the Memovira. She's out." One of the other guards, less phased, pushes the mutant back. He's a sergeant. "It ain't fear piss. It's the spit you're spraying when you talk. Why don't you go hatch your eggs by burying your face in a pillow? Real people are conducting business here." A second mutant, one who'd been observing the fracas, noticeably bristles. Actually, yeah, literally. Thorns literally emerging from his arms, shoulders, and face, and he pushes forward. "Every damned one of you looks the same. Two arms, two legs, no surprises. You want to collect our money? I'll make you eat it, and your friends can collect it from your rotting shit." The mutant punctuates each sentence with an increasingly vicious stab of its finger. You can feel a bloody tide rising, and if you wish to intervene, the clock is winding down. Well, I've gain the mutant's trust or choose a side by talking to both sides' leaders. Okay, so this is a crisis in which we can talk to people as well. So you have Aen-tozon over there on the side. We have the spiny mutant, the Memovira thug, Memovira sergeant, mutant, thug, mutant, mutant. There's a mutant guard. Young mutants. There's a crimper. Let's talk to the spiny mutant. Let's try to de-escalate this if we can. Hail. You focus on the thorn-covered mutant and the weight of your gaze turns his head. "What do you want, human? You want in on a long due bloodletting? You better talk fast. We're itching to get started." The spine-covered mutant's eyes remain focused on the Memovira's enforcers, his mouth drawing thinner and thinner. Asked the mutant leader how the situation started. He snorts. "They came to collect their protection money from the Memovira, but the Memovira can't enforce anything. She's weak. Everyone knows it. Look at these poor specimens. They can't even protect themselves." Skepticism and distrust mar the mutant's already unpleasant faces. They don't know or trust you. Eretus. Talk to Memovira, Sergeant. If you can. What would you have of us? Let's do this. Suggest that the Memovira's enforcers will come to check on the patrol shortly. Now, oh, I can't switch to someone else. Alright. Ask how it started. The sergeant coughs a bit, a wet hack, and says, "We make this route every month. We're collectors. It's our job to bring in revenues for the Memovira from her loyal subjects." He pauses as the mutants break out raucous, derisive laughter, then continues, but they laid in wait for us and got the jump on us as we walked into Little Nihliesh. The thugs seem calm for men whose lives are being threatened. They recognize the words, but they don't seem to believe they're in much danger. Okay, I'm gonna try to persuade or intimidate or whatever. Suggest that the Memovira's enforcers will come to check on the patrol shortly. I can get up to 95%. He opens his mouth to disagree and then realizes what you're saying. Ah, yes, of course. The Memovira keeps a close eye on our patrols. This money is important to our operation, and she sends backup to make sure none of it goes missing. They're bloody-minded bastards, too. The mutants' muscles tense as they lean away. They exchange worried glances. The thugs are alert, but they're not frightened. They don't seem to believe that violence is imminent. Callistes, can you talk to the spiny mutant? The spine-covered mutant's eyes remain focused on the Memovira's enforcers, his mouth drawing thinner and thinner. Persuasion. Is she any good with persuasion? Urge the mutants to keep the Memovira's patrol alive. Oh yeah! I figured 100% has to always work? Not sure. The mutant's leader looks at his fellows and back at you, and he makes some calculations. We understand you want to stay on the Memovira's good side, but this has to end, unless you can think of another way. We've got to put them down before they steal the last shin in Little Nihliesh. The eyes of the mutants no longer glower at you. Indeed, they almost seem intrigued. So, we got them intrigued. The Memovira's goons aren't welcome here anymore. Back off, mutant. This doesn't end well for you. Ask what the Memovira does with the collections. She pays us, mostly, and the mercenaries who come through the Maws, and the bribes to the Sagus Cliffs officials, but she's been falling further and further behind on those payments. He swallows and looks at the mutants around him. Like, as not she'll want vengeance if we fall. She needs this money, and she'll use her nastiest tricks to get it back. The mutant leader shifts his weight as the sergeant speaks, but he does not retreat. The thugs are alert, but they're not frightened, blah blah blah. So we can't talk to these others. Something's spitting stuff on the floor. Ask how the Memovira might retaliate. Didn't they just do this? She might indeed send backup, and they might indeed kill us, but at least we won't be paying her blood money. Am I not right, friends? The mutants no longer look to their thorny leader. They're watching you. They want to avoid violence. Can't do these. Or he can't do these. What would you have of us? Oh, nothing at all. Ask who is in charge of this area. This arouses tight laughter from the assembled mutants. You'd recognize Garakoto if you saw it. Our prince lives in a tank in the center of Little Nihliesh. Not big on mobility, our prince. Laughter resounds again, and then the mutants focus on the enforcers. The mutants trust you now. It may be your only chance to resolve this without violence. Well, I have no more actions left or something. Prestige. Ask what kind of leader Garkoto is. The thorny mutant steps back a moment. Garkoto is wise. Garkoto is crafty. Garkoto thinks in circles and in mazes to find the best results for our people. Garkoto almost never takes direct action, says that hasty choices become their own legacy. Well, shouldn't you follow his example then? Takes your poxy hides to get gone, human. You want to answer to the Memovira? Oh yeah, good. Remind the mutants that Garkoto would likely not approve starting a war with the Memovira. 100% right off the bat? Cool. Well, the prince did tell us to keep to ourselves, heads down like. Garkoto might be angry if these goons die. The mutant's eyes soften slightly, but his thorny fists remain clenched. Yeah, I have no... Persuade the mutants to let the humans go. The mutant's leader looks at his fellows and back at you, and he makes some calculations. As you say, he replies, scowling at his companions. He says to them, these are deaths that we can save for another time, eh? No point in bloodshed with outsiders witnessing. They too look at you, and some unspoken agreement fills their eyes. Well, they'll kill them later. The human sergeant wastes no time. My thanks, he says over his shoulder as he hustles his troop toward the exit. We won't forget this. Much obliged for your help. The Memovira will hear of this. Bye! Interesting, okay. This ancient stone structure seems out of place in the bloom. Similar buildings are scattered around the chamber as if an entire town was swallowed up by the bloom and deposited here in the distant past. There's another maw waiting there. You can see vague figures moving around inside the bubble-like house. It's not clear how they get in or out. Alright, let's talk to these guys. Mutant, spiny mutant. Probably better that we didn't kill those thugs. We scared them, and now they'll treat us with more respect. Once, just once, I want to show the Memovira's goons how strong they aren't. Spiny guy. Those humans were lucky we're there to help. Next time you won't be. And they won't be either. Alright. Thought Spiny guy would have something more to say to us. I guess not. Oh, you have all those verd things. Did you smell those goons before they ran away? At least one of them filled his trousers. Do you think those goons will come back? If they do, I'll bet they bring more friends. So yeah, there's some more there. A spherical tank, that's where there is. Oh, container interior? Cool. So yeah, guys, welcome to Little Nihliesh. Hope you survive the experience. This statue depicts an eyeless, many-breasted mutant. It appears to be screaming. What? It looks like a skull with, I don't know, that got destroyed. I don't know. Let's talk to Aen-tozon. A stunning man in formidable garb greets you with arms wide open. His golden eyes stir strange, unbidden feelings in you. really. My friend, he says, spreading his arms, welcome. I am Aen-tozon. The sound of his deep, rumbling voice makes you think of a waterfall at the rise of the morning sun. The rise of the morning sun. Beatific and profound. It makes you feel drunk. Drunk. He talks further, but you can't really follow what he's saying at first. It's just such a pleasure to hear that voice. Then you feel a sensation like an icy finger on the top of your skull, and the warmth spreading through your limbs cools. The image of the glowing waterfall cascading through your mind dries to a trickle. Aen-tozon trails off, watching you curiously. Study the man. You watch him quietly for a moment, and something odd happens. His gaze thickens, drifting away from you, as though you have vanished, as though you are only visible to him when you are speaking. And yet, you feel that probing warmth within your mind, like fingers searching a dark space for treasure or food. Are you trying to hypnotize me? No, not trying. Trying requires effort, and the effect is quite beyond my control. He says with a slight genuine smile. The effect is caused by my passion for studying the web of connections between people, even separated by words or, he pauses, his smile fading, death. Even in death, connections persist. And he thinks, I'm surprised he's still as coherent as he is. Oh well, it's just a matter of time. Who's he? Not me. His humor continues fading. He seems thinner now, frailer, less human. His voice is a dry, papery, ancient thing. My studies took me all over this world and to lands beyond the stars before I finally came to the bloom. Here, my hunger took on a more literal meaning. With careful hands, he opens his clothing, exposing a maw, one of the bloom's sentient mouths. You sense otherness beyond it, a gateway to a place beyond this one. I told you that my studies changed when I came to the bloom. One of the maw's tentacles winds around his wrist. This is how a maw claimed me. Now we both feed, quite harmlessly, mind you, on the connections between people. I understand the sensation can be quite pleasant. What? The tentacle slips reluctantly from his arm. If you wish to feed us, bring a close friend to visit us. We will be here, waiting. I've brought an ally to feed you as you asked. Would any of them satisfy you? Aen-tozon closes his eyes and concentrates. A silky heat fills the air. You feel comfortable, lazy, happy. He holds one hand before him, centered on your chest. Then his finger moves. To Calistige. Over to Aretas. To Tibir. A wide smile consumes his face. Declare a name, and I will feed. Calistige? I mean, you have a lot of people there. Good, he says, rubbing his hands together with a rasping sound. A pleasant, insidious warmth streams through you, lacing every vein with pleasure. Tell me, he says, turning to Calistige, tell me how you met. Now, I don't really trust this guy, but he says it's harmless, and I don't seem harmed by what he did. So, Calistige speaks, but you can't focus on her words. You feel the heat of her regard for you diminishing, but find it momentarily hard to care. Oh, went down. Through the thunderous pulses of pleasure, you see tentacles spilling from within Aen-tozon's clothing, a maw opening. A pale, transparent figure steps out. Who the hell's that? He's just walking away. From whatever world lies on the other side, he turns this way and that, perhaps attempting to get his bearings. Seeing Aen-tozon and his maw directly behind him, he scampers off to the side to create some personal space. On finally noticing you, he gives a cheery wave. Aen-tozon conceals the maw once more, then gives you a tremulous smile. Your companion falls silent with a puzzled expression. Did we go down with her? She still reveres me. Kwherezimian? Kwherezimian. Calistige? You okay over there? Intellect? Do we use some of her intellect? She adores me. Alright. Aen-tozon doesn't welcome you with his rolling golden words this time. He merely nods in greeting. Still, a touch of that hypnotic calm rolls over you. Do come back any time. Okay, who's this? You came out of that maw. This pale, ghostly figure wears outlandish clothes and a horned helm. Opaque, tangled scars from an unfamiliar weapon loop and curl over his transparent body. Oh, he says, tilting his head. You! Have you found my brother yet? He thinks, one of these trips I'll stop being surprised. Was I supposed to be looking for him? Really? He says, groaning. You told me you'd... He trails off and slaps his forehead. The impact makes his helm tilt forward, and he puts up his hand to hold it in place. Of course. Right. This is the first time we meet, isn't it? He straightens, holding out his hand formally. Hello. I'm Kwherezimian, and I've been traveling through time and looking for my brother for millions of years. Nice to meet you. He thinks, bet he tries this time. Shake his hand. Your hand slipped right through his, and he punches the air in delight. Ha! You almost never fall for that. That'll keep me going for at least another 100 times of you not trying to shake my hand. He catches your eye and shrugs. The motion makes his helmet slip forward again. Hey, I've been doing this a long time. You find entertainment where you can. At any rate, let me know if you see my brother, huh? You came out of that maw. Are you connected to the bloom? To the what? He looks around. Oh, no, I'm not. I just sort of, well, let's call it swim between places. Following currents, you know. Someone pulled a plug and here I am. How many times have we spoken? Thousands? Good question. Yes, right. He says, consulting an invisible mental list just above your head. Thousands, I'd say. Always a pleasure, mind you, though I don't know why we keep running into each other. I don't see anyone else more than once. He squints. If I had to guess, it's your relationship with the tides, but I don't mind. It's nice seeing a familiar face. He thinks, she's probably the closest thing to a friend I have. Are you a ghost? I like to think so, he says, shrugging, but I don't really remember dying. Just the traveling and searching. And you'd think this helmet wouldn't keep moving around if I was, you know, spectral. He flashes a grin. So he liked to think he's a ghost. On the other hand, I seem to remember promising my brother I'd haunt him when I died, so that's some evidence for the other side. What are those scars from? Scars? He says, looking down. Oh, those look painful. No idea. Have to say I'm glad I don't remember, though. What's the helmet about, anyway? So glad you asked, he says, and he looks it. I love this story. He centers the helm on his head. I ended up on his battlefield once. It was... well, it hadn't gone well for the side wearing these helmets. I walked up this blackened hill, followed the shouting, and saw... it was probably a city once, but it was on fire and covered in black flames. He shakes his head. The helmet doesn't move with him. There were just two fighters left, the big man wearing this helmet, and... her. She was huge and made of screaming shadows in that same black fire, and when the warrior charged at her, roaring, she just touched him. She touched him and he fell over, twitching and burning. He looks up at you. One of these times you told me she was called the Sorrow. Since this is the first time we've met, I'm guessing you have some questions for me. What? They were fighting. The Sorrow destroyed a city? A big one, around the size of three Saguses and a bloom. But the people of the city were abusing the tides in some way. From what you told me about the Sorrow, that sort of thing makes her really unhappy. He straightens the helmet again. But I didn't think they deserved to vanish, despite whatever they'd done, so I took the helmet off the warrior when he'd, you know, stopped melting a bit. Now I carry it with me to remind me of them. Hold on. You know about the tides? Of course I do, he says, then raises a wary finger. Sorry, forgot. First time, you know. They pull me from place to place, like normal tides do. It's why I keep seeing different times and places, and never stop in any one place for long. Tides don't rest, and neither do I. He yawns again, even wider. It's a little tiring sometimes, or at least I think I'm tired, which is probably the same thing. Hey, he says, focusing on you, can you actually sense the tides flowing through me? No. Well, let's fix that, he says, cracking his ghostly knuckles. Got a little blue tide. Before you can react, he thrusts all five fingers through your chest. The feeling isn't unpleasant. In fact, you feel the tide surging through his arm, through you, and you see them curving back over your shoulders and back through him, binding you together. There. It should be easier for you to sense the tides now. Just remember that she's out there. Flowing around with the tides doesn't seem to make her mad. Abusing them? I don't recommend it. Cool. Skill level has been increased by one. Current skill level is specialized. What did you do to me again? I made it easier for you to sense and control the tides in other people. Don't worry about paying me. My pockets don't work. What does your brother look like? Well, sort of like me, minus the helmet, he says, thinking. And he's from a world long ago, so he might be wearing... He pauses. Oh, right. I do this every time we meet. It's just that I usually go centuries between running into you, and I always forget that you can't have possibly seen him. He winks, but there's a touch of sorrow in it. Oh, don't say that word. Still, let me know if you see him, huh? It's always worth a shot, he thinks. I won't give up on him. Where is he again? A world long before this one. Millions of years, probably. Maybe more than that. But I'll see him again, eventually. See you next time. Probably, one of these maws. Wondor. Wondor. The structure was built in a style you've never seen before. The stone is pitted and ancient. Well, everything seems to end over here, so let's talk to Crimper. And we'll work our way further and further. Downward somewhat. This filthy old man is dressed in a motley of rags, arranged artfully to emphasize the inhuman reach of his needle-like fingers and the two protruding humps on his back, as if his mutations are a source of pride. He wears smoked goggles on his forehead, parked above his transparent eyelids and his noseless face. His teeth are small, even, and shining white. He shows them often as he smiles to himself. His pockets are filled with trinkets and baubles that he has picked from the piles of trash. He raises his head and says, "Yeah, what have we here? Who comes to disturb old Crimper? Have you come to search through this bounty with me? You're welcome to share." He looks at you keenly. "Share, you hear? What are you doing here?" He lowers his head and grumbles, "Yeah, what does it look like I'm doing? I dig and I answer questions for fools. Not everyone in a trash heap is trash, but wastrels abound. Why waste? Why waste indeed?" He combs to a mound of trash with uncanny speed and precision. He thinks, "Taurus, always bothering Crimper. Have you ever found anything valuable here?" His tone instantly softens, sounding almost pleased. "Oh, yeah, people lose all kinds of treasures in the trash." He sits back and pushes up his goggles. "Unexploded detonations, blocks of metal that spark and steam with nanospirit swarms, a marble with a cloud of insects inside, half-used healing injectors." He beams. "A collection as vale, even. That brought me many shins." "Oh," he thinks, "oh ho, perhaps Crimper is wrong. Perhaps this one is interested." "Tell me more about the treasures you found here." "You mean the Kalaxtrian as veil? Most your age don't catch such things. It was a simple sonic emitter, but it had the power to twist thoughts and change perceptions. And once I found a vial of spraying energy armor," he frowns, "by the time I knew what it was, the light of that breastplate had melted away and the vial was empty." He brightens again. "But treasures! Such treasure!" "Too many to recount. A gold pile this trash mine is." "What's the best item you found here?" "It was this. He fumbles around in his pockets, slapping at his shapeless rags before he reaches a hidden stash and pulls something out. It's an ugly, vomit-green cylinder made of organic material about half the size of a forearm. Covered in knots and whorls and tendrils, it looks like it might still be alive. I found this a year ago. It was buried near Kodo's tank, and I would have missed it if I hadn't wriggled. Listen. He squeezes it and sets it down, and the thing begins to sing in a slow, discordant tone. The device shivers and rolls around on the ground, hooting and piping through tiny mouths in its tendrils and whorls, and then issues a melancholy belch. The mouths close, and the thing ceases its movement and speed. He titters a bit. I laugh every time. I had to shed blood for this one, eh? Some human thought to take it from me. He drops it into one of his outer pockets. He thinks, it was my only comfort the night young Gottly disappeared. Helped me through, it did. Tell me about that song box again. He pulls the device from his outer pocket. If anything, it's uglier as you remembered. Uglier than you remembered. It also seems to be dripping some kind of fluid. He beams as he squeezes it again and laughs aloud as it rolls on the ground. This might be valuable to someone, but I'll never part with it. Too much pleasure. He drops it back into one of his voluminous outer pockets. It seems like little Nihliesh has an awful lot of trash. This is the midden for the bloom, to be sure. I've crossed through many chambers and cavities, but none of them have this kind of refuse. We mutants do not make this much mess, and new piles of garbage appear daily. So much work. Should I try to steal it? Farewell. Child. You asked plenty of questions about the refuge and the hidden treasures here, but not so much about finding treasures of your own. Have you ever dreamed about picking your future from the ground? I could show you all, yes. He thinks, an apprentice, maybe? I haven't had someone learn from me since young Gottly. I'd be happy to learn whatever you have to teach me. Gold tide, tiny amount, and blue tide raise a small amount. Good, good. The first possession in your hand should be on your hands. A trash picker needs gloves or skin like synth. Stone, glass, and odura combine in these piles, and like as not, some sharp shall pierce your skin. You want none of the fluid in your core, child, or you end up like Crimper here, or poor Vrung, not right between the ears. Well, I'm looking for that guy. For Kian, I think is her name. So he gave us an ancient spirit cube. He continues in that vein for a long time, leading you to various trash piles. This one, pick clean. See how the pile is strewn, and behold, a pile of last resort. You want those relatively undisturbed. You spent some time looking for newer piles, and you're rewarded with the pleasure of sifting through some organic goop and chemical-scented tailings, but eventually you find something that may be useful, and you pocket it. It's an oddity. Ancient spirit cube. Intricate patterns are carved on all sides of this small metal cube, which fits comfortably in the palm of your hand. It spreads warmth throughout your body. This is something we can actually use. Now over here, the others hit the pile quick, but not deep. You want to go deeper than the surface, yeah? But you need to go fast and careful. He shows you how to dig through a larger pile quickly and safely, maneuvering around jagged chunks of broken synth, shattered strong glass, and splintered wood. At the end, you find an interesting piece, and you take that, too. We got an Everlit. Oh! Another oddity. This looks like an ordinary white candle set on a metal base. Its material is firm, pliable, and doesn't burn or melt. There is no wick. An illegible inscription is engraved on the metal base. When you turn your eyes away, a flickering flame lights up the room, casting dancing shadows. The flame always disappears when you look back. You learn quickly. You have a true gift. Come back and share some time with me, child. Having paid careful attention to Crimper's lessons, you feel that you can now locate other treasures in the trash of little Nihliesh. Cool. I guess we have an added ability to find things. Farewell, child. Well, now we could look through. You sure you don't want to give us the song box thing? Hi here, child, you return. Have you a chance to test your skills? Find anything else that dredges your fancy and appears like a shining, unexpected toy in your hand? Tell me again why Nihliesh has so much trash. He pushes back his goggles and shrugs. The bloom drops it here. All over the bloom, all through the bloom. Even places on the far side of the bloom, little cultures I'll never see. Their food and clothing and tools wind up in the trash, and their trash winds up here. I'm tempted to steal that thing, I really am, but that wouldn't be very nice, right? I'm sure I wouldn't improve my gold tie, that's for sure. Oh yeah, farewell to you too. So now we can get something from here. So I have to use that thing and see what happens. The trash piles of little Nihliesh illustrate perfectly the prevailing attitude that the mutants are garbage, only barely tolerated. The scent of unidentifiable refuse, leaking organics, and the sharp smell of melted synth combine in a particular odor that makes your stomach churn. But something catches your eye, a glint of metal perhaps, something shiny, dramatically out of place in the ooze and decay. Diggin'. Broken Lascar Helm. The disgusting garbage pile shifts a number of times as you shift its ordure aside, and the metal you glimpsed remains tantalizingly distant. At last, though, you see a broad patch of metallic surface and snatch it before another avalanche of fetid waste collapses over it. Its helmet is similar to those worn by the Lascars you have met. Were they looking for that? Well, they're looking for their friend. We need to go to one of those maws. The encrusted filth of the bloom covers this helm's surfaces inside and out. It looks like it would fit a human head, but the technology that created the helm is far beyond the capabilities of anyone in the Ninth World. Lights flicker from inside, and the helm intermittently broadcasts short bursts of speech in a female voice. We can use that, too. All right. Find more stuff?
Ready.
No matter how you poke and prod, you find nothing else of interest in this pile of garbage. That's pretty cool, though. So I can't use that. It looks pretty expensive, though. I can use the helm. Oh, it's a quest item. You examine the helm more closely. It gleams underneath the crusted filth, worked with a skill unmatched in this age. Its crest seems to contain a number of dark black cells that catch and hold the light. Fine traceries in the cells look as if they might gather or disperse energies. It looks as if it could fit on your head. Look inside the helmet first. The dark and padded interior has some faintly glowing nodules and soft synth fibers, but no visible eye slits or any breathing apparatus. More importantly, the helm has been collecting rotting garbage and debris for what looks like decades, and as you scoop out the sodden mass, you discover fragmented bone, possibly that of the previous owner. You clean the helm as best you can.
I'm ready to learn something new.
Our machinery lore tells us that closer examination of the interior suggests that it connects with its wearer through eye movement tracking. Once it synchronizes with the eye movement, the helm's internal circuitry develops a direct neural connection with its user. You suspect that it might also store past users' experiences and observations. That'd be awesome. This thing would be like a mirror, right? A mirror caster. Now that the helmet has been cleaned out, you can see it's padded inside with some dark, soft dark synth. Let's try it off his eyes. The helm was clearly custom designed for a specific person's head, but you can fit it around your skull with some fierce tugging. The odor of decomposition fills your nostrils, as well as the accumulated filth of the bloom's trash. It'll smell delicious. It is pitch black in the helm. No eye slits or breathing apparatus are immediately apparent to you, but after a few seconds, a small light begins to blink in the corner of your visual field. As your eye automatically flickers to it, the helmet's air clears, degassing the foul stench, and you can feel the air circulating from hidden pumps inside the headpiece. Several unfamiliar symbols light up on the right side of your visual field. Most are dim, but one symbol shines brightly. If you had to guess, the dim symbols mark functions that are unavailable at this time. Look at the bright symbol. A grid of smaller images appears. The bloom, pictures of the starry night sky, and images of various people. Let's look at the images of the bloom. Among the many images here, you see several that depict places you have been, though their particulars have changed since these images were captured. You suspect that years have passed. The first image is of the vast interior chamber, its pathways and tendrils sprawling across the empty spaces. You see foul gases curling from the depths, a row of shops and upwardly built homes, and caravans pulled by Aen-tozon traversing the strands. The courtyard outside the Memovira's fortress seems subtly different, and you look at it for a moment before two observations strike you. First, the uniforms of the guards are quite different from those who serve the current Memovira. You also notice that this image was taken from where the container's wreckage sits now. The area still looks as dingy and dangerous, but the lack of the container makes the space seem more open, less oppressed. I don't even know what the container is. I know it's over there. We can go inside it, apparently. The next image is of the bloom, seen from a path descending from Sega's cliffs. Though you already had some sense of its immensity, its massive bulk momentarily takes your breath away. Wedged into the cleft between two massive encampments, the bloom is both wide and long, with taut and massive tendrils anchored to the rock face. It looks as if the creature is dragging itself toward the inland sea, very, very slowly. Yeah, it seems to move at a different rate than we do. The final images in this collection depict little Nihliesh, but not as you know it. Most of the people you see are ordinary humans. Garkoto's great tank is nowhere to be seen. The piles of trash are smaller, and the ancient stone buildings still serve as habitations. Though an aura of squalor and disrepair taints the place, and you can almost smell the garbage, it seems nearly idyllic in comparison to current reality. These images must be at least a decade old. Now if I look again, I guess it's the same thing. Yeah. Look at the images of the night sky, then. When you look at the first image, it expands outward again, showing a vast grid of other sights. Clearly the owner of the helm took great care in recording the images of the night's world sky. Either she loved the stars desperately, or she was collecting these shots to cross-reference with some other collection.
Making a note.
Have found something, the helm's former owner says. Must be certain. Must return to the anchorage and compare new data with the navigational cortex's archives. Look at the images of people. The pulsing, moist walls of the bloom form the backdrop of all these images, your guess is that the helm's original owner met each of these people during their visit here. You see Drakogen's tall form looming over a smaller man. Drakogen's smile is sharp and fierce, and the threat implicit in the way he holds himself tells you that he is about to exact some punishment on his quaking client. The next array of images shows the observant Speck, who looks exactly the same as she does in the current time. The diminutive woman is gesturing dramatically, probably in the midst of telling a story, an animated arm and coy smile shining through the static picture. The next images show, from a distance, the distinctive outline of Waitsburg prey, its spikes and blades held in a threatening pose. Some unfortunate challenger is facing the construct, her electrified blade looking pitifully inadequate to the task. Here, we got rid of that thing. The final images of the three human men. One of them holds aloft a jagged piece of strong glass, its end bloodied. The owner of the helm holds up a hand to ward off another blow. Blood gouts in the air. So if we look again, we get the same thing. Now, what if we hadn't met Waits? What if we had just bypassed Waits for Prey, hadn't gone to see the observant spec, would it still show us these? Take it off. As you lift the helm, you see the symbol wink out, leaving the helmet's interior in darkness. Interesting. Now what about this thing? Well, I can level up as well. Let me do that. ability. % per training level. Flash. Mind control. Let's take mind control.
Did I learn that or remember it?
Both. Anyway. Alright, I wanted to go into inventory. And check out this ancient thing, ancient cube, ancient spirit cube. Use. You hold the small metal cube in the palms of your hands. It spreads warmth throughout your body. You can barely make out a soothing voice whispering softly. Listen closely to the voice. Putting your ear closely to the cube, the words are starting to become clear, if fragmentary. Mighty warlords, yet so small. So you shall understand me. Your help. Not free, wisdom to bestow, like so. It rapidly rattles off a series of instructions and then starts repeating them. You're not entirely sure you could follow them, or what would happen if you do. The cube is repeating the instructions on how to connect its power source, but they are spoken too quickly for you to understand. Oh, is this for the... Hold on. For some familiar skies. A recording I found on an old helmet suggests that its owner was on the verge of an important discovery. She had planned to check her data with something called the navigational cortex. The owner of the helmet was never able to complete her work, but maybe I can. Bring the helmet to its owner's people. In the recording, the helmet's owner spoke of returning to a place called the Anchorage. I should try to find this place and speak to her people. They might be able to tell me more about her and the cortex she mentioned. And rumblings of discontent. Now that I've found both patrols, I should return to Bruskin and tell her what happened. I encountered one of Bruska's missing patrols in Little Nihliesh. They got into trouble with some mutants, but I helped them escape. Alright, so... this thing... a hilt without a blade. Power source. This might be the power source. Or maybe not. It's something else that needs a power source. I don't even know. Let me use our machinery lore. It's so loud. Lore machinery and mystical. Try to figure out the cube's instructions. 100% success. You can figure out most of the instructions, and once the intelligence points them out, the connectors and activation methods seem obvious, but a few steps are explained in an obscure manner. Go back to go forward. Revolve the crux. Go forward to go back. Only now. Final. Inspect the device closely, seeing how the different parts fit the odd instructions. Each step matches a specific part of the device. It seems you have to detach the power source to rotate the core of the device, after which you can safely reattach the power source and switch the device on. Alright, follow the instructions. I guess we don't try pressing all that different stuff. Now we know what to do. Follow the instructions to switch the device on. The cube hisses and releases some kind of energy outwards through your arms as it courses through your body, exploring your form somehow. It takes you a moment to realize that as it passed, it left new, unfamiliar memories etched into your mind. These memories appear to have belonged to an ancient automaton craftsman, and they increase your understanding of all things mechanical. Cool. Machinery is being increased by 1. Lore machinery. Current skill level is specialized. Oh, I have permanently gained 1 intellect pool. My max is now 22. Nice. Oh, it's gone. The cube itself became cold and deadly silent, and then begins to fall apart in your hands. You scavenge some valuable bits from the object. I gained 140 shins. Is it made out of shins? Interesting. Okay, so... Codex for this place. Little Nihliesh. It's the trash heap of the bloom, as if the bloom used this cavity as some sort of filtering organ. It is the home to a collection of mutants led by Garakoto, whose people live among the squalor and debris. The back end of the katana can be seen here, its opposite end protruding into the Memovira's courtyard. Oh, really? We can get through that way? Back to Memovira's courtyard? Hmm. The whole middle section of this building is gone, erased from existence by something that passed directly through. The most likely culprit is the vehicle that rests a short distance away. Right, that katana thing. That thing I've looked at. This appears to be the back end of the crashed vehicle you saw in the Memovira's courtyard. Cool, we can just pass through that thing.
I'm going.
She's going. We can find something else here, apparently. Ah. 23 shins and a Fleetfoot Moss. I think we ran out of Fleetfoot Moss. It'd be cool to have it again. Yeah. I wish I could make this window larger so I can move things around easier. I like to put all my consumables here. Yeah, it's good enough. We can't walk on all this. There's a lot of trash. Hmm. Young mutants! Do you wish to join the X-Men?
Of course.
Of course they do. I think these two want me to die. No one who ever went into that wreck came out again. I heard Auron has been missing for days. We're trying to get Alopo to check out the katana, but he's got the heart of a dossier. A dossier? There was lots of neat Numenera near the katana when it crashed here, but all the stuff that was easy to find is gone now. Yeah. People ruin everything. That's that. Well, we're gonna mess with Garakoto last. Oh, we haven't talked to this Wondor. As you approach this bulk of stone and fur, it starts to move, becoming less of an inanimate object and more of a man. Before you stands a giant figure with a beard so thick it seems like sculpted granite. But when you see his gentle eyes, a tangible wave of peace washes over you. I am happy to see you, Adahn. Is that name from Planescape Torment? He speaks carefully, as though every word is a step upon icy ground. You have been gone too long. He thinks, the Peacebringer. It would be good to repay my debt to her. She is a good woman. I'm not the woman you think I am. Gentle confusion crinkles the mutant's stony brow, making a sound like boulders shifting against one another. It is me, Adahn, he says slowly. Wondor. Perhaps it has been too long. Perhaps you do not remember me. His shoulders sag as he says this. I'm sorry that I've made you unhappy. Gold tiny mount. Do not be sorry. You must help many people. It was foolish to think you would remember me. He thinks, it does not matter. I will help her if I can. Why have you returned, Adahn? Can I help you in any way? How are you, Wondor? Better than before, he says shyly. Better than before we met. Then there was sadness in me. Rage and sadness, fed by my many thoughts. But you found the stranger inside me and took it out. He spreads his rocky palms. Since that day, I have felt peace. He thinks, sadness at once, rage at what? It no longer matters. How'd you find peace again? You took the stranger away from me, he says, his brow shifting. You took the sadness and the rage away. Who was this stranger you mentioned? I do not know, he says, shaking his head back and forth four deliberate times. But it entered my head in the accident. It was heavy, like a golden stone. It made my thoughts faster, but sharper. They made me sad. They made me angry. The warmth of his smile ripples across his face. But you told me you could help. You took out the device, took away the dangerous thoughts, leaving me calm. Simple joy fills his eyes. You said you had more use for thoughts than I did. What were the thoughts? They are hard for me to remember now, he says carefully. That was blue-tied. But it was my voice. You should not have left them, it said. They are gone because of you, it said. You must learn from this, it said. He shifts uneasily. But when I tried to learn from the thoughts, they increased. They shouted. They would not leave me alone. He thinks, I do not know what they mean. I do not need to know. It was a device in my head that made me think. You took it from me to help me. Farewell? Yes, Adahn, farewell. I have no idea what that's about. What should be? Oh! Trash! Some trash stuff over here. Oh, that's like... Let me see. Wasn't it more over here? Let me try. Yeah, nothing. Okay. I thought we could find something else. We could find some... We can get something here, apparently. 40 shins. Take that. If we find anything to buy, we can, Yeah, I'm gonna bypass this completely for now. There's a maw.
Without doubt.
Without a doubt, it's a maw. What are you doing here, human? Little Nihliesh is not for your kind. This thing doesn't grab me. I wonder what this maw eats. Arrogance, perhaps. Or the color green. Or girls with antlers. Those are pretty random things. See that maw? It erupted out of the wall and destroyed my damned house. Well, I'm going to take this. 20 shins and an amplified encephalic rush. Yush. We're finding lots of goodies here. I am not messing or speaking with the maw just yet. In fact, I'll talk to a Garkoto first, or whatever his name is, first. Okay, I have Encephalic Rush and Amplified. You don't scare me, buddy. How do I move this stuff? It resets, damn it. I want to put this... Where's the encephalic rush? Oh. Okay. Alright, let's talk to, Herja. Oh, another beauty person. This striking woman towers over you. Though she seems gaunt and her skin is pale, even whitish, she still has a healthy glow that shines through a layer of dirt and grime. A flat circle of metal is affixed to her forehead, showing through her long blonde hair. At your approach, she begins to flex and tense, not in fear, but in preparation to fight. Her heavy armor is scarred by energies and battered by blades, but it seems to have retained its integrity. The sigil of two crossed swords is etched into the breastplate. She glowers. Have you come to beat the poor prisoner? Then be ready to tell your friends about the day Herja bested you. Then she studies you more closely. Or have you come to question me? Tell Gorkoto that my answer is unchanged. He can rot in his soup. She pauses for a moment. I would appreciate an honest soup. The food they provide here would shame a Murden. She thinks, now that the mutants have enlisted humans to make me confess, they are sick. I don't work for Gorkoto. I'm a visitor to this place. Lutide. She presses her hand to her face, making a show of her embarrassment, but she still looks wary when she draws her hand away. My apologies, then. The mutants demand that I confess to a crime I did not commit, and I thought they were sending a human this time to break my will. She looks around. It will be good to speak of other things with a true-blooded human. What are you doing here? These mutants have accused me of a crime. They tell me that I must confess to this imaginary horror before they will let me go. So here I sit, rotting away, while they ask me to choose between the truth and my freedom. She rolls her shoulders and looks you squarely in the eye. I choose to honor the truth. She thinks, they have no laws and no souls. There can be no crimes against them. What's that sigil on your armor? She looks down, frowning, as if she had forgotten she wore such an emblem. This? This is the symbol of the Angulan Knights. The crossed blades represent our ability to step beyond the laws of nations in order to deal true justice. We seek to reclaim the world for humanity's light. Can you tell me of the Angulan Knights? Her face lights with passion. The symbol of our order represents our willingness to step beyond the bounds of propriety and advance the cause of humanity. She looks around and lowers her voice. Actual humanity? You know. She tosses her hair. If we must take up the blade to mete out justice, we do not hesitate. We travel Midgard for the betterment of all, and those who oppose our mission soon see the error of their ways. In the steadfast, the order of truth itself blesses us. Midgard? That's like the Norse word for earth. These seem like the, this game's version of, Cerberus. Bettering the cause of humanity. And, being kind of not giving a crap about anyone who's not human. I am a knight marshal in our organization, and I have proved myself many times over, and I will continue to do so as long as I draw breath. She leans back, her eyes closing. Our hunger for justice brings a great physical hunger as well. One council, I recall, they brought us fresh waters distilled from the dew of the mountains, roasted and spiced anine, and exotic flaming cheeses. We do not ask anything of those we aid, but sometimes their largesse humbles me. She smiles. Our founder, Angul, thought to make a world suitable for humanity. The ancients left wonders, yes, but they also left a legacy of horrors and dangers. We seek to mitigate those dangers and to remove those horrors, by word or by blade, and to make the world safe for its true heirs, humanity. If we sometimes must step beyond the bounds of propriety in order to achieve that goal, so be it. The council has granted me the rank of knight marshal for my works, and when the mutants here release me, I will return to my brethren with reports of my activities. Until then, I can only hope for the intervention of someone who hungers for justice as much as I do. What can you tell me about Gorkoto? The mutant prince? I need to remember the mutant is both male and female. Swims in its disgusting stew of a tank, bathing in its own filth, and somehow it summons powers that keep the rest of its creatures in line. They said Gorkoto was a wizard. I didn't believe them until the mutant imprisoned me with its powers. What part do you want to hear again? How it lives as both a male and female? How it can't survive outside its tank? How it captured me and imprisoned me within its spell? She waves her hand dismissively. I'm tired of talking about the mutant. Ask me something else. I want to talk about the allegations against you. The mutants claim that I poisoned them. A number of them died, and they decided that I was to blame. She frowns. That is all they are. Allegations. Garkoto has no right to imprison me. The exit is over there. You could easily overpower the mutants. Why don't you just leave? What happened? Oh. For a moment her eyes threaten to tear, and then she steels herself. Prince Garkoto has cast a spell on me. Here, let me show you. She steps toward you, reaching a hand out to grasp your shoulder, but before she can touch you, her fingers begin to bend, as if they had encountered an invisible wall. You see? But in case you think I jest with you. She hurls herself at you, shoulder first, until she rebounds dramatically, staggering backward. I am confined to this space until I confess. Too bad we didn't get an animation of that. Test it for yourself. You lift your hand and wave it through the air. You can even step close to her, and you feel nothing. She takes your hand and says, "Now step back." You do, and at the exact same point where she rebounded from the air, her hand is torn from yours. They have to have their criminal. I suppose I fit their bill. Why have you been imprisoned? Because they require someone to blame for some deaths among their people, and they chose me. The scum look for someone different from them, and I happen to be nearby. She barks an unpleasant laugh. At this point, I'm inclined to show them what kinds of horrors I could visit upon them. She thinks, I will not confess to her. It is too great a risk. Confess to her. Confess. Tell me your crimes. She stares at you for a moment. I am here because these despicable mutants need someone to blame. They think someone poisoned them. They're mistaken. Look around. Does this place look healthy to you? Farewell. Angul, protect and guide me. You can dimly make out a misshapen figure that huddles under the makeshift shelter. Its head lolls against the ground, nearly twice the size of its body.
I am the very soul of action!
Is Delnian Vrung? Is Garkoto? We can't even walk that far.
Sure enough.
Okay. Stay tuned for next episode when we confront Delnian Vrung. We get some loot. And most probably then after that talking to Garkoto. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next one. And enduring. Grow strong.